Out of the darkness of the deep range and into the light of the deep strange. Cometh the hour, cometh the mothership that is Coast to Coast AM. John B. Wells in the left seat tonight. And how are you doing? How are you? Good to be with you tonight. Well, last Tuesday was Guy Fawkes Day. Did you celebrate it? What? Did you celebrate Cinco de Mayo and you didn't celebrate Guy Fawkes Day? Well, you get the poem anyway. Remember, remember, the 5th of November, the gunpowder treason and plot. I know of no reason why the gunpowder treason should ever be forgot. How about this one? It wrenches our hearts the 11th of March, the horrid tsunami and quake, a hot Fukushima and the MSM treason for failing to cut us a break. A floating island of debris three times the size of Britain is heading for the California coastline, sparking huge environmental concerns, you think? 5 million tons of rubbish made up of devastated homes, boats, cars, and businesses is making its way across the Pacific Ocean following the 2011 tsunami in Japan. Scientists have already discovered debris on the West Coast, but their latest findings suggest California is expected to be hit with a deluge. All at once. America's National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, that's NOAA, you know that, in case you didn't, I had to look it up. They released their latest findings showing a huge island of rubbish floating northeast of the Hawaiian Islands. Boffins, that's back office intelligence, have been unable to say for certain whether the debris will wash ashore, but they have been closely monitoring its movements, which stretches from Alaska to the Philippines. 7 months ago, the first documented debris from the tsunami reached Crescent City, California. A 20-foot boat belonging to the Marine Sciences Program at Takata High School in the northeast city of, Rikuenza Takata, was discovered washed up. NOAA spokeswoman Keely Belva said more than 1,600 reports of debris had been firmly traced back to the tsunami. Okay. Mainstream media doesn't want to touch it. Oh, they'll touch it and then back away from it. They're about to remove the spent reactor rods, fuel rods, at reactor number 4. That could be a problem. So I'll cut you a break, because you need to know. Posted at 7:22 in the morning, Saturday morning, the 9th. It's a crime what's happening at Fukushima. People resettling areas 10 to 15 kilometers from plant with, quote, radiation levels still very, very high and even lethal in some cases. Hotspot 60 to 70 kilometers away, same level as ghost towns in Chernobyl. A newspaper. Patronizing silence from officials about Fukushima contamination in West Coast seafood. It's downright irresponsible. They are telling us nothing. Expert says there is a real cause for concern. Nuclear expert. There may be an accident of criticality during fuel removal at Fukushima Unit 4. TV says rods could crumble, frightening TEPCO in charge of potential catastrophe. Japanese lawmaker, children coming down with many health problems. This is reality. Even CNN says many parents of Fukushima blame nuclear accident for higher cancer rates. One more. Another TV station with a report stating Fukushima is potentially the biggest ticking time bomb in human history, an enormous problem that's getting bigger. Scariest part is what could still happen. All right, then. I'm going to stay largely out of the way while the following forum participants do their thing and tell us everything they can in the time that we have allotted for this program. Up first, Arnie Gundersen, 40 years of nuclear power engineering experience. Next, David Bloom, Alcohol Can Be a Gas, is his book. He is the executive director of the International Institute for Ecological Agriculture. Number three, Dr. John Apsley, his book, Fukushima Meltdown and Modern Radiation, Protecting Ourselves and Our Future Generations. I'll of course, give you their websites as we go through the evening. Number four, Stephen Starr, associate member of the Nuclear Age Peace Foundation, has been published by the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists. His writings appear on the websites of PSR, the Nuclear Age Peace Foundation, the Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology Center for Arms Control, Energy and Environmental Studies, Scientist for Global Responsibility and the International Network of Scientists Against Proliferation. All right? You wanted it. You know, I sure would like to be wrong about all of this. I really would like the DA award of the new millennium. He was just so completely full of it to keep beating his shoe on the desk of his studio, just like Khrushchev was beating his shoe on the desk at the UN, saying, "We will bury you." I don't think he really meant it. I think he was just bluffing, but this is no bluff. Fukushima is a serious incident. It really does threaten the seas. It threatens humanity. Now, as Zen Master says, we'll see. But first, let's thoroughly examine the problem in as much as we can. Stand by for Arnie Gundersen. This is Coast to Coast AM, Saturday night edition. Strap in tight. Here we go. All right, Arnie Gundersen, 40 years of nuclear power engineering experience, attended Rennes des Serres Polytechnic Institute, or RPI, for those like myself who can't pronounce the name, where he earned his bachelor degree cum laude, while also becoming the recipient of a prestigious Atomic Energy Commission fellowship for his master degree in nuclear engineering. Arnie holds a nuclear safety patent, was a licensed reactor operator, and is a former nuclear industry senior vice president during his nuclear power industry career. Arnie Gundersen also managed and coordinated projects at 70 nuclear power plants in the U.S. Topic tonight, Fukushima. What else? Welcome back to the program, Mr. Gundersen. It's a pleasure to have you with us. Thank you.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Well, some say, that stuff's not radioactive. There's not that much radioactivity getting into the ocean, but the reports keep coming in from everybody but the mainstream media, so let us have it. How bad is it, and what's your appraisal of the situation?
Well, there's an enormous amount of radiation getting into the ocean, and it's not going to go away for years. There's a plume, what we call them, about heading across the Pacific, and it's likely to hit the West Coast within the next year, maybe even 6 months. The contamination in it is cesium-137, 134 from Fukushima, and it's about 10 times more radioactive than the cesium that was in the ocean from bomb testing. So, yeah, we'll be seeing a plume of cesium hit the coast. And, you know, unlike a cloud of smoke that passes over, Fukushima continues to spew cesium into the ocean, and strontium, too, I have to add. So the net effect is that the spigot hasn't been turned off yet, and we're contaminating the Pacific Ocean in the process.
Now, I understand that this stuff does not disperse as it moves out into the ocean, but rather remains concentrated from the surface of the ocean down to the sea floor. It doesn't all just settle to the sea floor. Is that correct?
Right. Yeah, it's not heavier than water. It's very, very small particles that sort of float almost like dust in air, so that it is moving in the entire water column across the Pacific.
Have you been over there recently?
I was there twice last year. I haven't been in 2013.
And you must still have sources in Japan that you speak with.
Yes, I do. And they're just as concerned, if not more so, because, of course, the radiation on their side of the Pacific is a lot worse than the radiation on our side of the Pacific.
And most of the debris, this island of rubbish that's three times the size of Britain, that's a pretty good-sized island. They say most of it won't be radioactive at all. I can kind of see where that might be the case, but I don't know. So I guess I'll ask you, what are the chances that that stuff is hot?
Well, you know, when it went into the ocean from the tsunami and started moving out to sea, it was uncontaminated because there was no explosion at that point.
Right.
But we do know that that ships at sea became contaminated. You know, the Ronald Reagan was off the coast of about 100 miles off the coast and became heavily contaminated when it sailed into the radioactive plume several days later. And you'll recall there's a large number of naval personnel who are now in a lawsuit suing the condemnation of Japan and the United States government, I believe, for putting them in harm's way. So, you know, if the Reagan got contaminated, it's likely that the material that was floating on the surface of the ocean got contaminated.
And the Reagan, of course, is the aircraft carrier.
Yes, yes. So if the soldiers and sailors on that aircraft carrier swept the decks with a soapy foam in order to get rid of the radiation. So the plume of material that's floating on the ocean, of course, didn't have that. So it's likely when the rubble hits the coast, which is different than the plume of radiation that's in the water, but it's likely when that pile of rubble hits the coast, we will find radiation in it. It likely won't be on the flat surfaces where, of course, you know, authorities will measure the flat surfaces, but I think the action of the ocean over 2+ years will wash it off of that. It would be in the nooks and crannies in the rubble that you're likely to find some radioactive debris.
Now, when you have a marine layer, I take it that marine layer of the foggy, misty effect that we have in the mornings in California, I take it that that's produced from seawater.
Yeah. You know, I'm not too worried about the froth of the ocean throwing up a lot of radioactive material onto the land. But we did have radioactive material hitting the land back in 2011. We were lucky enough to put up air filter monitors in Seattle. And these things were designed to draw the same amount of air that a human lung drew per day. And then we would take the radiation from these filters and lay it on an X-ray film and do what's called an autoradiograph. And you could actually see the hot spots from particles that had been wafted across the Pacific on these filters. And the average person in Seattle, in essentially the end of March, all the way through April and into the beginning of May of 2011, was breathing in about 10 hot particles a day that had wafted across the Pacific. So we had that experience, and then about 50 days later, we saw it a second time, and that's the second time the plume went around the Earth. But I'm not too worried about airborne coming off the ocean and affecting people that jog along the coast or anything like that. What concerns me are the fish. You know, we've got contamination of the aquatic chain. We've got the little fish eating the bigger fish, eating the bigger fish. So the top of the food chain animals will likely become contaminated. And I sure wish the government would announce the results of the test. If it is testing fish, and I really don't know if it is, they're not telling us the answers. And I don't think that's I want a transparent process. I want to make sure that as an informed consumer, I can make the decision whether or not to eat those fish or not.
Yeah, you know, there were some reports about fish being affected all the way up to Alaska. And then there are some who are saying, look, this whole Fukushima thing is being blown out of proportion to the point where every environmental problem that's being experienced on the North American continent's west coast is being attributed to something to do with Fukushima. So, you know, there are the naysayers out there that say, nah, it's nothing. What are we hearing about as far as contamination of seafood here? You know, the bluefin tuna that were caught last year, I think it was, they all tested positive for cesium-137. And but that was it. That's the only report that I've seen surface regarding fish caught on this side of the ocean.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. The bluefin that were caught 5 months after the accident, and they became contaminated in Japan, and they swam all the way across the Pacific and were caught near California and did test positive for cesium. And I agree. That's the only test I've heard of. I went out and bought some salmon last week, Alaskan smoked salmon, and the good news is I tested it, and it tested clean. Now, it wasn't a meaningful sample. It was, you know, I bought a couple of slices of salmon and send it off to the lab. But, you know, I love salmon, and I was I said, wow, I probably got another 6 months before I have to begin to worry again.
Yeah. Yeah, and well, one of these fish, I think, crossed the made the trip from Japan to California and back three times in less than 400 days, I want to say. I don't have the data right in front of me, but that fish was moving, and it made three round trips.
Oh, yeah, I know. They're amazing. You know, and they were growing dramatically. So the fish picked up the contamination in Japan, and then their and cesium goes to their muscle. So their concentration off the coast of Japan would be was very, very high. And then as they swam, they continued to grow and essentially dilute that cesium out with extra body mass plus whatever they excrete it. So my guess is the fish that are being caught off of Japan are, in fact, much worse than what we're going to be catching off of the coast of California.
Is there any way to get a good number on how much radioactive water is actually making its way from the plant site at Fukushima into the ocean? I've heard it. There's a range where they have about 200 tons to play with. I've heard 400, and I've heard as many as 600 per day.
Well, even the bottom number there is pretty bad. You know, 400 tons of water a day is an astronomical amount. You know, it's always been leaking into the Pacific ever since the plant was built. They made design decisions to cut the cliff down, and groundwater has always been leaking into the Pacific. So TEPCO should know that number pretty well because the number likely hasn't changed. But what happened, of course, after the accident is that these basements and these power plants became extraordinarily contaminated. So before, TEPCO was pumping clean groundwater out into the Pacific, but then now that the groundwater is entering the plant, it's becoming contaminated. So they do know that they're building tanks at a rate of around 400 tons a day. And each one of these big tanks is about 1,000 tons. So they have to build 2 to 3 tanks a week to keep up with this. That's the water they're capturing. And it's roughly the same quantity that they're not capturing and is heading out to the Pacific. We know it's continuing to leak, even if you don't know where it's continuing to leak, because the ocean concentrations are not going down. Now, if this thing were stopped, the concentration in the ocean would have started and then ended, but it's not ending. Now, the Japanese are talking about building an ice wall around the entire plant. Ice has been used before. It was used to straighten up the Leaning Tower of Pisa. The tower was leaning a little too far, and they were worried about it. So they put ice under it and pushed it back up, and then shored up the foundation. And it's still crooked if you go over there, but it's just not as crooked as it might have been. But nobody's built one a mile and a half long. And it's going to take about 2 years before they finish this job. So, you know, people are saying, oh, they're building a wall, it's going to stop. Well, that's 2015 before they can even try to see if it achieved the goal it was meant to achieve. I'm not convinced that where the ice hits ground, hits bedrock, that you're going to get a good seal. So they may go 2 years into this, build this wall, and then say, whoops, it's not working.
All right. Arnie Gundersen, when we come back, let's talk about the removal of those fuel rods, and let's talk about any health issues that may have been reported to you from your sources in Japan.
Great. Looking forward to it.
Okay, me too. And I'll stay out of your way, and you just let it rip. All right, let's take our little break now, and we'll come back with Arnie Gundersen. This is the Fukushima Forum on the Saturday night edition of Coast to Coast AM. You know, I'm not really interested in conspiracy theories. I'm interested in actual conspiracies, and I like to retire those theories as quickly as possible. People have said there was a bomb put out there in the trench, deliberately triggering this tsunami and all of this stuff. I don't know about that. Do I think governments are monstrous enough to do something like that? Oh, yeah. I'm just not sure that I think that's what happened in this particular case with Fukushima. And when we come back here in just a moment, I want to be sure to ask Arnie Gundersen about the proper way to read radiation levels. Perhaps he can advise us. Reading radiation levels in water, food, etc. Many people have gone to caravantomidnight.com and hooked themselves up with radiation detection equipment, otherwise known as Geiger counters. But I understand that it's difficult to read radiation in food, so we'll get Arnie to put us straight on that, if you will, and we'll be right back. Make yourself a proper cup of tea, but hurry, because we're coming back quick. This is Coast to Coast AM. Arnie Gundersen, you know, I'm not trying to scare everybody to death here. It seems I saw a cartoon one time that had two pictures, one above the other. The first one is here are these little primitive men. They got their spears and their beards and their little fat bellies. They're sneaking up on this big, nasty beast. They're going to get it. And then it wakes up and turns around and growls at it. In the bottom picture, they're all running from it. You know, we'll deal with this like men and run. So on that last 7.3 quake, I think it was 7.3 on the scale, the authorities at TEPCO said, run away, something bad may happen. But I didn't hear any reports that anything did happen that was bad. But I'm not sure I would in any case, or any of us would. So did multiple question here. Did anything happen after that quake? And if the answer is no, not really, then let's move on to the fuel rods. And I understand there's a potential cluster Fukushima potential there.
The quake was 7.3, but it was 200 miles off the coast. So by the time it gets to land, it's probably felt more like a 5. So I'm sure that that there were leaks in a tank farm, which is the 1,000 tanks, each of which has 1,000 tons of water in it, up on the hill above the plant. But structurally to the plant, I wouldn't expect it to have any damage. TEPCO just reported today that there is another leak in the tank farm. They don't know how long it's been going on. So I wouldn't be surprised that the seismic event they had last week caused that leak and others that we're not hearing about.
Is the world rushing to their aid, Arnie, or is the world not rushing to their aid? Now, I hear both sides. I hear, oh, yeah, we got a lot of technicians over there trying to help them. Is this true?
Well, yeah, I've had a bunch of companies call us at Fairwinds, and they've said they've actually gone over and begged the Japanese to accept their technology, and they've been rebuffed. So the world probably would like to do a lot more than the Japanese are allowing. Now, Prime Minister Abe just came out and said we want help, but frankly, I think that's just window dressing. They really don't want adequate help because I think they're afraid of what they'll find. We're being contacted by Japanese doctors and Japanese scientists. The doctors are told by their hospitals that they can't tell their patients that the symptoms they're experiencing are radiation induced, and we have scientists who are afraid to, lose their jobs if they publish the information they have. So there's a real bottleneck in getting any decent information out of Japan right now. And the only thing that's saving us is the internet. Now, this happened at Chernobyl, and it happened at Three Mile Island when government controlled the printing presses. Well, with the internet, we control the printing press. Unfortunately, the government's still sitting on the information. So I'm hoping that over time, information comes out that a lot of good people over there are sitting on right now. Because they're afraid to lose their jobs, or they're afraid to have their careers terminated when they tell us the truth.
You know, it's one thing if you get in an airplane and you're with a pilot and you don't know how to fly, and he said, and you get up in the air and the pilot says, he or she, some good lady pilots up there, trust me, they say, go ahead and take the controls for a minute. You go, okay. You know, some people will say, no, I'm not touching it. Others say, okay, can I turn it this way and like that? Because they know that the instructor, the pilot, will save them if they do something silly. But it's another thing if you say, get in the plane and take it around the patch. No big deal with no training at all. You're not going to get very many takers on that. So you either are skilled and educated as to what you're doing, or you're close to somebody who is skilled and educated in what they're doing. And trying to find credible information, it just goes back and forth. I heard somebody say, well, if the molten nuclear material will go ahead and just burn all the way down to the center of the Earth, we'll be fine. And my response was, what? Then I've heard, well, that thing was caused deliberately by a bomb going off in the trench, and it triggered this tsunami. And then I've heard somebody else say, you know, we could put a small nuclear bomb right there on top of Fukushima, and maybe that would solve the whole problem. I mean, do you hear this stuff too, or is it just me?
No, I hear it. I hear it a lot, especially the why can't we hit it with a nuke and blow it to smithereens? You know, if a nuclear bomb is the solution, what the heck is the problem?
Yeah, really.
There's an enormous amount of radiation in those buildings right now. So if we were to obliterate them with a nuclear weapon, it would actually make the problem worse worldwide.
That's kind of what I'm thinking.
Yeah. As far as the issue goes of the somebody setting off a weapon in the trench, it's actually worse than that. We knew this tsunami was coming. There's the historical record dating back 1,300 years shows that every once in a while a tsunami that's 45 feet tall hits Fukushima Daiichi. And in our hubris, we didn't think it would happen on our shift, and it did. So, you know, Mother Nature always bats last, and Mother Nature always bats 1,000. And she took out a $10 billion investment and created a $500 billion liability. I don't believe it was caused by foreign agents or anything like that. I think it was just time, and we failed to listen to the historical record. And listen to our ancestors, essentially. But the evidence was clearly there that this accident was preventable if we had just read the record correctly.
Well, you know, we pride ourselves here at Coast to Coast AM by avoiding politics like the plague. But unfortunately, it seems like the more serious the situation, whether it's a naturally occurring disaster or a man-made disaster or a combination of the two, a natural disaster that results in a man-made disaster that's just waiting to blossom, that's when the politics get the thickest.
Yeah. You know, this whole problem is exacerbated by politics in Japan. TEPCO, Tokyo Electric, should be replaced before they remove the rods in this Unit 4 spent fuel pool. They were an operating company. They weren't an engineering company. And we're relying on them to engineer their way out of a problem that nobody on the planet has ever faced before. So they've got the wrong skill set. But it's worse than that because they also don't have enough money. The Japanese government, and here's where the political side comes into it, the Japanese government wants to start 50 nuclear power plants out of the 54 that were in Japan before the tsunami hit. And if they told the people of Japan that, oh, by the way, it's going to cost us $500 billion to clean up Fukushima Daiichi, it's really unlikely that they'd get permission to start up those other 50 nukes. So rather than step up to the plate, get rid of Tokyo Electric and say, hey, we're all on the hook here for $500 billion. It's easier for them to continue to blame Tokyo Electric. And, you know, that puts the Pacific Ocean at risk. So I think we're in a political turf battle here where the Japanese government would prefer to start up more nukes and in the process doesn't want to tell its people the truth.
I know nothing of nuclear anything. Certainly in comparison to you, but I have a question. This removal of the rods, these are the spent rods, I take it, at number 4. And there's a criticality potential if they crumble or if they touch. Is that true?
Well, first off, Unit 4 is the easiest of the four reactors to remove the rods from. So I have a hunch I'll be back on your show in the future here.
Please.
But the problem is that if they don't remove the fuel, the consequences of not removing the fuel are much worse than the consequences of removing it. You know, a serious earthquake, if the fuel stays in those pools that are 7 stories high, about 100 feet high, if those buildings were to collapse and they had the fuel in them, the consequences would be truly catastrophic. So you got to get the fuel out. Unfortunately, you're relying on Tokyo Electric to move the fuel out. So what happens is the fuel is in a rack, and it's like cigarettes in a cigarette pack. When you get a fresh pack, you can, you know, easily pull one cigarette out without damaging it. But if you squeeze the pack and then try to pull a cigarette out, you're not going to be able to pull them out without, one, damaging the cigarette or breaking it. Well, these racks are like that pack. They've been squeezed. They've been in a seismic event. They've had the roof fall in on top of them, and they're the bundles, the fuel bundles, individual cigarettes, if you will, are not going to come out very easily. So there's two problems. One is when they go to pull on the bundle, they're likely to snap a few. And this has happened in the past in American reactors. When you do that, you release radioactive gases. Krypton 85 is the biggest one. It's not filterable. So it will have to go out a roof vent and be released and expose people within the prefecture of Fukushima, like the state of Fukushima. So the problem number one is that they'll evacuate the refueling floor, and then they'll suck the air out of the building and go back in and continue the process. So that's problem number one is a snapped bundle. Problem number two, though, is what you were referring to. Sources have told me within Tokyo Electric that they have no confidence that there's any boron left between these fuel bundles. And you need boron to prevent the nuclear fuel from becoming a self-sustaining chain reaction, a criticality. So without boron in the plates, and the reason that is that there are plates between these fuel bundles, but they got extraordinarily hot from not being cooled for a better part of a couple weeks, and they also were exposed to salt water. So that combination likely stripped out the boron. So the only thing Tokyo Electric can do is throw all sorts of boron into the water and then pull the fuel. I used to build fuel racks when I ran a division that built fuel racks. And these high-density fuel racks like they have at Fukushima are very close to going critical anyway. We call this thing K-effective. And normally it's 0.95, and it can get as high as 0.99. That means there's a 1% margin before a self-sustaining chain reaction can occur. So what the problem there is that the fuel pool doesn't have the ability to remove the heat if these nuclear fuel bundles turn back on. And a criticality means they turn back on outside of the nuclear reactor. So they have to be extraordinarily careful, again, that they don't start a chain reaction in the fuel pool. You're supposed to have chain reactions inside the nuclear reactor. You're not supposed to have one in the fuel pool. There was something out on the web, if they touch, it's apocalyptic.
Right.
If that's not true, but if they get close together, you can cause a chain reaction. And what will happen then is not a nuclear weapon, but the water will begin to boil violently. And hopefully, Tokyo Electric's going to be monitoring this process really closely, and at the first indication of water bubbling, essentially steam, they push the rods back in. The problem, though, is that the rack is distorted, and as you pull it, you're pulling against way more friction than it was ever designed to handle. It's a real problem, but again, I got to go back to how we started this, that the risk of not doing anything, leaving that pool the way it is worse than the risk of pulling that fuel. Now, unfortunately, it's Tokyo Electric doing it.
Arnie Gundersen, we have 5 minutes left in this hour. What a fast hour. Tell us, if you can, about the proper way to read radiation levels in water and food. Do you know that might not be your thing, but if it is, let us know, would you?
Yeah, the it's very hard to measure the radiation level in food because there's something called self-shielding. If you have a big hunk of meat and the radiation's in the middle of the meat, the gamma rays or beta particles are going to be captured in the meat before they get to your detector. So it's really it's really hard to measure the radiation inside the fuel, inside the food. More importantly, though, a lot of people are going out and buying detectors, and there's a bunch of good ones on the market. And you'll see them, especially in Japan, but a lot of people in the U.S. are also doing it. What you're measuring with that is the gamma rays that are bombarding you from mainly the soil, but also from the sky. But you're not detecting what you're breathing in. The Japanese, you know, as their kids play in the dirt. I was over there and I took 5 samples in Tokyo, and all of those samples would qualify as radioactive waste here in the States. One of them was in a school playground. So these kids are playing with that dirt, and it winds up on their hands and in their mouths and, of course, in their gut. And the same thing, you know, the dirt gets breathed in. So when people walk around with these detectors, they're measuring the sort of the background, I guess I'd like to say, of the contamination that's on the ground. But they're not measuring what's been kicked up and what's in their lungs. The same with food. You can't just lie a Geiger counter on a hunk of meat and get a good reading.
Right.
You need a pretty darn sophisticated device that's, you know, $20,000 to $50,000, something that, you know, not many civilians can afford to use. But
right.
We got to demand that our government release those numbers. I know they're doing it, but we just don't know what the numbers are.
Health problems that they're that they're experiencing over there. I take it that this is happening. I'm hearing all sorts of horror stories about cancer levels are going up, and people in the area, children having problems, all kinds of stuff.
You know, the Japanese are meticulous and they keep good records. And before the accident, they had excellent statistics, essentially state by state, prefecture by prefecture, about cancers and stillbirths and spontaneous abortions and all that kind of stuff. They haven't published anything in 2011 and 2012, so that's that's an indication that the information's out there, and they're just afraid to release it.
Well, I'll tell you what. Would you very quickly tell me, and everybody else here, what's the situation with number 3? Some have said that the situation at reactor number 3 is worse than number 4. Is that true?
Yeah.
Or do we know?
The problems on Unit 4 are going to be a walk in the park compared to the problems on Unit 3.
Ugh.
Unit 3 is incredibly structurally compromised, and the explosion was much more forceful in Unit 3 than over in Unit 4. So, you know, what they learn on Unit 4, perhaps they'll be able to apply on Unit 3, but the damage over there is much greater. So
gotcha.
My fear is, yet it has, the fuel has to be removed for the same reasons. You know, the building's compromised, et cetera. So, you know, my fear is they've got to move quickly on Unit 3, but the radiation levels inside the building are so high that human beings can't go in it yet.
Understood. Well, I'll tell you what, Arnie, please, if something breaks, call us. We'll be calling you. If both of us get a busy signal, all that means, if you call us, you get a busy, and we call you and get a busy, that means we're calling each other. So let's stay in touch, okay?
Okay, great. Looking forward to it.
Thanks for coming on the program, Arnie Gundersen. All right. Next, Mr. Bloom.